As you know, the town offices are being sworn in tonight because they had to be sworn in at the first business day of the year. And so the town clerk asked if I would swear in the four Glocester members so that they can be part of today's meeting. So Amy, Pat, Cindy, and Mark, stand. Please repeat after me. I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will be true and faithful unto the state.
That I will be true and faithful unto the state.
And support the laws and constitution thereof. Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the charter and ordinances of the town of Gloucester.
The charter and ordinances of the town of Gloucester.
And that I will well and truly execute the office.
That I will well and truly execute the office.
That I have been elected to.
That I have been elected to.
For the term of said office.
The term of said office.
Or until another be engaged in my place. Or until I am legally discharged therefrom.
Or until I am legally discharged therefrom.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
The town did prepare a certificate, and Beth is handing you the certificates. School Committee 101, because as Shelley and Brendan said, they may be a little late. And I want everybody to know that it's been Brendan all along for the past year that's been asking for School Committee 101. School Committee 101, some variety of it, is presented to all the school committees in the state at local meetings, and then parts of it are being presented by the School Committees Association. A lot of it may be repetitious, but we try when we go to the individual school districts to make it more specific for you. I will entertain questions, obviously from the school committee, as we proceed. Okay, so what is school committee in Rhode Island? School committees are the creation of the Rhode Island General Assembly and are limited in their authority by federal and state law. So you are a creature of the state of Rhode Island. There are three laws that govern the school committees. Rhode Island General Laws 16-9, Rhode Island General Laws 16.9.1, and Rhode Island General Laws 16-11. Those are the three school committee statutes that govern what you do. Rhode Island General Law 16-9 states that the entire care, control, and management of all public schools, interests of the several cities and towns shall be vested in the school committees of the several cities and towns. I'm not reading to you all of these duties under 16-9. I will provide you with a copy of 16-9, and you can have a copy of this PowerPoint. I'm sure you can all read, and you don't need me reading all of the general law. 16-9.1 is the Code of Basic Management Principles and Ethical School Committee Standards. Once again, I have no problems providing you with the statutes, and I have no problems providing you with this particular PowerPoint, so you on your own can read it and always can ask questions as you have it. Other than the two statutes that we just mentioned, there are sources of authority through the Rhode Island Department of Education. RIDE is given authority by the General Assembly in Rhode Island and may control some of what you do. One of the things that they use to control what you do is the basic education plan hearing about the basic education plan when you, whenever you do your strategic plan, and it basically directs school committees and school administrators as to what they should do in just about all areas of education in Rhode Island. It used to be a lot more detailed 10 years ago, but when it was revised, it did become less detailed, and it does give school committees through their administrators more power. There are additional regulations that will come up through Rhode Island Department of Education. You'll see these that'll show up every so often. They go through the superintendent, and then she will share them with you. Commissioner advisory opinions. Lots of times when there's something that's a gray area, we will ask for an advisory opinion, and then you will get an opinion from the commissioner. Now, an advisory opinion is not mandatory, but God help the school department that doesn't follow the commissioner's advisory. And then there's guidance. That is not non-binding, but there will be guidance. And then the superintendent of schools. There are three big issues that you as a school committee are involved in: policy, budget, and the superintendent. When you do read the Rhode Island general laws, what you're going to see is a lot of the general law will say, develop a policy for X, develop a policy for Y. So even though you have some control, you have the control through the policies that you adopt as a school committee. Obviously, you have to adopt the budget, and as many of you know, we're presently working on the budget. That will go in front of the budget, that will go in front of the taxpayers in March. You as the school committee adopt the budget that's recommended by the budget subcommittee and the superintendent, and then that budget will go in front of the voters. These are your three main responsibilities of the school committee. Some tips. You as a school committee, you individual members, often get calls from constituents, parents, concerns. Your role as a school committee person is to refer that question or concern to the superintendent. You are not, as a member of the school committee, you don't have the authority to contact individual principals and or administrators. So if you have a problem with something at the high school, you call the superintendent, you don't call the building principal. If you hear of a problem in the maintenance department, you call the superintendent, you don't call the director of maintenance. Everything goes through the superintendent. You should not visit schools without notifying the superintendent. Now, obviously, as a parent, you can go in any school you want in your role as a parent. But certainly, if you just want to visit, or you want to see what's going on, or you want to know what's going on, you need to notify the superintendent that you're going to be here. Because once again, everything needs to go through the superintendent. She will then tell the principal to expect a visit. The fourth one on this list, sometimes I get a lot of flack when I write it the way I do, but as a school committee member, you're not allowed to interfere in special education matters. Special ed is governed by federal statute. We do have regulations in Rhode Island, but basically it's a federal statute that Rhode Island has adopted. So when it comes to a special education matter, not only do you as a school committee not get involved, the superintendent doesn't get involved. Special ed matters are run by special education teams, and if a parent has a concern in a special ed matter, they have procedural safeguards where they can either file a state complaint, they can file for mediation, or they can file for due process. But you, as a school committee, have no rights to hear an appeal on special ed. A school committee individual member has no power. Power comes from a vote of the majority. In order for something to happen in the Worcester Gloucester Regional School Department, five school committee members have to agree that that's what's going to happen. You as a school committee member have no authority over the hiring of personnel. This changed about 3 to 4 years ago when the General Assembly adopted new regulations and a new statute that said all hiring goes through the superintendent. Superintendent is in charge of hiring all central office people, principals, and then in individual schools, it's actually the principals of the individual schools who hire or who recommend hiring to the superintendent. So in terms of hiring personnel, you do not have that authority. However, your authority comes through contracts. So whereas the superintendent can hire an assistant superintendent, the superintendent cannot give that assistant superintendent a contract. Only you as a committee can adopt that contract. So your power comes in the actual contract in determining, for example, mostly what salary will that person have. But in terms of who is hired, you don't have that authority. Keeping in mind that all you hire is the superintendent, who's the COO, she runs the district the way she would run a major corporation, and you have the authority of hiring school committee attorney. You hire me, you fire me, that comes through you. I work for you, I do not work for the superintendent. However, given that day-to-day operations go through the superintendent, I have a lot of interaction with the superintendent on a regular basis regarding some of the legal matters in the district. But your control has to do with the superintendent. In some districts I've said what people would complain about, someone that's unhired, what I would say is, you can't do anything about that person. If you don't like that person, then fire your superintendent. But you can't fire or hire somebody else. Everything goes through the superintendent. Keeping in mind, what's your main responsibility? Why are you here? And I'm sure you had this intent when you ran. The first and greatest must be the educational welfare of the students who attend public schools. Everything you do needs to revolve around what are we doing that's in the best interest of the students. Again, the superintendent is the COO. You cannot interact with individual employees. It goes through the superintendent. Everything you do, you act through votes in directing the superintendent and legal counsel to take action. Keeping in mind that as an individual member, you can't direct the superintendent. There has to be five people who agree with your, what you want to direct the superintendent. You as a committee only act through a public meeting. Keeping in mind, again, that no decisions are made outside of a vote of the committee at a public meeting. Now, process and due process are important. People have a right to a fair, unbiased process. The committee is the body of final appeal to resolve issues in a district. Other than special ed, other issues are resolved by the committee. When you receive a complaint, forward it to the superintendent. Circumstances where this is especially important, hiring, discipline, special ed cases. Dealing with the media has become more and more difficult as an elected official now that we have social media. But our recommendation always to you is no comment is always preferred. Don't get in a situation where you make a comment and it's somebody thinks that you're speaking for the committee. It's always best to say no comment. Usually the committee has one person who's a spokesperson. So if there's an issue that seems to be controversial, it should be one person that speaks for the committee. Public statements made by members can be construed as admissions against the district or the town. So be careful when you respond to any kind of social media. Social media has transformed the way elected officials interact with constituents. Through social media platforms, elected officials share insight into their decision-making process, communicate with constituents, and provide updates during times of crisis. All I'm going to tell you is be careful. Most of the time, no comment is the best comment. cackle of your own social media accounts. If you have Instagram, if you have Facebook, cackle what you put on it. Try to keep it personal. Don't have a social media, Facebook, Instagram, school committee page. Believe me, it's only going to get you in trouble. Now let's talk about open meeting. You have to act in an open meeting. One of the concerns that we have is that sometimes you'll talk to somebody else, and we'll talk to somebody else, and we'll talk to somebody else, and we'll talk to somebody else. That is called a rolling quorum. If five of you have that discussion, now we have a rolling quorum, we have an open meeting violation. So be careful who you talk to. That doesn't mean you can't go out for coffee. That doesn't mean you all can't go to the band concert. That means that you're not going to sit around and discuss issues of the school committee with more than three people, because once you get to that fifth person, you have a rolling quorum and we have an open meeting violation. Some of the things you need to absolutely be careful of when it comes to confidentiality. Executive session minutes. Do not ever discuss with anyone outside the meeting what was discussed in executive session. Personnel matters. You're going to hear in executive session, you're going to hear personnel matters as a member of this committee. Be careful not to discuss it publicly. Student matters. Once again, students are protected by FERPA. Information regarding students is highly confidential. Please be careful and don't discuss student matters outside of a meeting. ADA matters. FERPA matters, I just spoke of, it has to do with students. It's confidential information regarding students. Medical records matters. You may hear something about a staff member, a student. That's confidential information. Please don't share it with anyone. We're going to be getting into negotiations with the union. Some of you will be on a negotiating subcommittee. You will negotiate on a regular basis. What happens at that subcommittee meeting is confidential. That subcommittee will then share with the full committee how we're doing in negotiations. That information is confidential. Usually when we're negotiating a contract, we agree to ground rules with the unions, and we agree that we will be confidential in the information and we will not share. Legal advice. Anything that between you and me is confidential. It's attorney-client privilege. I can't divulge what you told me. You can't divulge what I told you. It's confidential. It's attorney-client. Remember, I work for you. You are the client. I'm the attorney. District or personal liability. You will be hearing about cases, legal cases that come forward. During the course of your term, we may have cases with the Interlocal Risk Trust, who is our insurance carrier. You will hear details. That's confidential. And once again, and I can't tell you this enough, anything that's special ed is highly confidential. If you violate these confidential matters, you could be personally sued. So I don't say that to scare you. I just say that so that you understand. Let's talk about a school committee, and this is something that has been going on forever. A school committee meeting is a meeting held in public. What you do, the actions you take, are to be held in public. However, a school committee meeting is not a meeting of the public. You make the decisions, you make the comments, it's not a meeting of the public. And you'll see how there'll be times when I will say something is out of order because it's become more of a public discussion than a school committee discussion. Conduct, some of this goes without saying. Don't be uncivil. We can fight as much as we want. You can fight as much as you want to fight, but let's do it in a civil manner. When you want a legal opinion, please do it in executive session. If you have concerns ahead of time, give the superintendent a heads up. This is a problem. I'm going to be asking this question. Can I let you know ahead of time? Establish clear meeting procedures and expectations so the public is aware of the processes that we will be following. This again goes to the rolling quorum. You can't discuss any substantive school committee issues with a quorum of other members outside of a meeting. A rolling quorum, as I said, is you say you call one person, you call somebody else, you call somebody else, you call somebody else, we got a problem. Do not discuss matters in executive session which are not exempt from the open session discussion. There are rules as to what we can do in executive session, and there are rules as to what we cannot. In executive session, we follow the rules. Running an efficient meeting. Try to remember that most of the groundwork should be done by the subcommittees at a public meeting. For example, you will have a negotiation subcommittee, you will have a budget subcommittee, you will have your policy subcommittee, you will have your capital project subcommittee. Most of the work should get done at those subcommittees. A business meeting should really be limited to discussion and questions with actions taken. At your subcommittee meetings, you are not taking action. You are going over the items on the agenda, and you are making recommendations to the full committee. But at a subcommittee meeting, you are not taking actions. When a business meeting runs 3 or 4 hours long, it's not conducive to good decision making and not conducive to public participation. We haven't had a lot of those long meetings here in a long time, but let's remember that we don't want to be here for 3 or 4 hours. We want the subcommittees to meet, to give recommendations, and then we want to act as a school committee. Let's talk about public comment. Public comment is not required on a school committee agenda, yet it's best practice that we put public comment on the agenda. School committee cannot engage in a discussion with members of the public regarding issues not on the agenda. Public comment is not a time to engage in a question and answer. Generally speaking, comment should be limited to 3 minutes, and speakers may not speak more than once. That's the best practice. Let's talk about subcommittees. You can establish as many subcommittees as you want. In mind, the more you establish, the more meetings you're going to be going to. Subcommittees are advisory. Subcommittees do not make decisions. Subcommittees post their meetings. And unless there's an issue that has to be held in executive session, those are open to the public. If you go to a subcommittee meeting and you are not a member of that subcommittee, you can't be part of what goes on with that subcommittee, because we can't have more than four people at a subcommittee. Once I have, or you have, 5 people, you now have a quorum and it's a full committee. So any subcommittees, when tonight you're going to be picking what subcommittees to go on, you can have no more than 4 members. If there are 4 members and anyone else shows up, you're a member of the public at that meeting. Some subcommittees are all executive session. For example, when we start negotiating the contract, those subcommittees will be executive session. So you are not on the subcommittee for negotiations. Don't waste your time coming to a negotiation subcommittee meeting. You're going to be sitting in another room. School committee, what is the role of the school committee co-chairs? You notice how Shelly still has a mouse? I'm going to give her a test on this afterwards. Your school committee has traditionally, and past practice, had a chair from Glocester and a chair from Foster. When I was reviewing one of your policies, an old policy that we're going to need to update at our policy subcommittee, it talked about a chair, it didn't talk about 2 chairs. However, I don't remember when Foster Glocester didn't have 2 chairs. The role of the co-chairs. prepare the agenda with input from a superintendent, maintain order in meetings and facilitate discussion, establish regulations. The chair shall have the authority to appoint members to a subcommittee. It's also one in the, it's also in your policy that a school committee chair can appoint. So if enough of you don't volunteer for these chairs, these committees tonight, I think Shelley and Cindy will be right there to put you on committees whether you like it or not. So when we get to that item on the agenda, I suggest that you volunteer. You're going to retain the rights to engage in discussions, offer solutions, questions, entertain proposed motions. You serve as the authorized signatory to all legal documents. Most of the legal documents that we have, memorandums of understanding, it's usually the co-chairs that we ask to sign. The chairs may call for a special meeting of the committee. They may be the ones that serve as a spokesperson, and they're the ones that oversee the superintendent's evaluation. You will all be involved in evaluating the superintendent, but when that evaluation gets put in place, it'll be the two chairs that are actually, the two co-chairs that are actually overseeing that process. School committee vice chair duties. You're going to perform the duties of the chair when the chairs are absent, and your biggest duty is you review the monthly invoices paid by the district's business office and recommend approval or appropriate changes. So that means that whoever the vice chair is going to have to go review the bills on a monthly basis. What's your role as an individual member? As we stated earlier, as an individual member, you have no authority. Your role is to read your agendas, to show up at meetings, and vote, and you participate, you're going to participate at the meeting for discussion, with deliberation, debate, and voting to follow. And once again, I recommend that when you get your agenda, if you have a question, you call the superintendent ahead of time so she can be prepared to answer any question that you have, rather than asking it here, where either she has to look it up, or whether it may be a lengthy discussion. Policies. Please put in. Policies come through the policy subcommittee. You can propose by the committee members or the superintendent. All policy development require an analysis that's including clear identification of the problem, relevant data, information and input, statement of financial implication, alignment with the district's stated philosophy, mission, and goals, and coherent with state and federal. She got more? Law. Policies, again, all go through policy subcommittee. Policies all go through policy subcommittee. A new policy or policy shall be considered at two separate meetings before adoption. This is what your policy that's in effect says. A new policy or amendment will be effective upon the date of adoption by the committee and will supersede all previous policies. The committee shall make exceptions to the above requirements when the immediate adoption, amendment, or repeal of a policy is in the best interest of the district. School committee questions. The way it's done in the region, the vice chair comes in on a monthly basis and goes over all of the bills. The vice chair will then turn around and recommend or not recommend to the full committee at a meeting whether they should be adopted or not.
So they don't really approve them?
No. They review them. I'm sorry, they review them
they
so
review
that the
them.
Full committee, yes.
Yeah, and then they bring any discrepancies
yes.
to the committee.
Yes.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Okay, I have no problem sharing this PowerPoint with the full school committee so that you can see it. And I will also send over the laws that we talked about so you actually have a copy of those laws available to you. No questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.